Well, good morning, VCF. So glad you're here. I'm back from a week of intense demolition work, and my body's still intact. My arm does sound, if I move it, like I'm twisting rope. Not sure what kind of an injury that is, but hopefully that heals in time. We're going to be in the book of Galatians this morning, so if you have your Bibles, turn to Galatians, and we're going to be in chapter 2. We're going to finish up chapter 2. So you might remember from last week, we talked about how Paul uses the laws of logic and reason to present proof for the power of the gospel unto salvation. Now, I have a few good friends here in the congregation who have pointed out to me that I like to present the gospel in nearly every sermon that I preach. I assure you that's not on accident. I do that on purpose, because I strongly believe that the gospel is central to the entire New Testament, and it's also key to understanding the foreshadowing of the Old Testament. The gospel's right at the center of all of that. In fact, D.A. Carson used to say that you can take any passage from the Old Testament, and it's a trajectory that points to the person and work of Christ. Of course, another reason is that the point of our faith and the gathering of our worship, and indeed our life, finds its centrality in the person and the work of Christ. But this morning, there's another reason that we're going to explore today. And that is that the gospel has implications. I've often said that the gospel is very simple, but the implications are in the millions. The gospel is very simple, but it implies many things. And so I want to point this out and explore it this morning. If we become unfamiliar with the gospel, we become unfamiliar with gospel living. So here's what I mean by this. The gospel that Paul's describing in Galatians thus far gives us an explanation not only in the path to a right relationship with God, but the implications of a right relationship with God. So far, Paul's introduced us to the material point of having a right relationship with God, and it starts with grace. So think back to the beginning of this letter. He says, grace, and I wrote, this isn't just a greeting. Grace is the means of our salvation, God giving us a gift that we don't deserve. So he begins the letter by saying, grace and peace. Peace because of a right relationship with God. Grace and peace to you from God, our Father, and the Lord Jesus Christ, who gave himself for our sins to rescue us from the present evil age according to the will of God, of our God and Father. And of course, a little later in verse 14, but when God, and you might remember that from chapter 1, but when God, that pivotal point going from spiritual death to spiritual life, but when God, who set me apart from my mother's womb, called me how? By his grace. Paul says it in another way in the letter to Timothy. This is 2 Timothy 1. He says, he has saved us and called us to a holy life, not because of anything we have done, but because of his own purpose and grace. This grace was given us in Christ Jesus before the beginning of time. So this grace was given to you and to me, not because of our works. We've been exploring that all the way up until this point. And today, in this passage, verse 11 through 21, Paul's going to overtly say that justification comes by faith in Christ alone. But this also has implications for us. It implies something. If God loves us this much that while we were yet still sinners, Christ died for us, there goes Pastor Casey preaching the gospel again. If God loved us so much that he sent his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him will not perish but have eternal life and can come to God and have a right relationship with him, that implies that because we've been given this new life, that we ought to live in this new life. Walk in a manner worthy of the gospel, or as Paul says it in the passage today, walk in line with the truth of the gospel. So if you have been transformed by Jesus, you've been transformed by the gospel, there are implications that your life would show evidence of that transformation. So this is what we're going to explore this morning. We're going to talk about something that gets in the way. And I think this is probably something that's that primarily gets in the way of having a robust and strong faith and a good relationship with God. And I think it's this, the fear of man. And we're going to see it in the passage this morning. So what I want to talk about is the fear of man. What is it? Why is it a problem? I forgot I left that in there. What is it? Why is it a problem? And how to not to? I wrote that as a joke when I was making my slides, and I was going to change that, but I forgot. So my friend Derek Peterson, when I was in Iowa, used to say this phrase. I would say, hey, Derek, we really need to go to the timber, and we have to cut that tree down today because it's getting kind of dangerous. And I mean, we might be putting ourselves in danger as well. And he says, we need to figure out how to not to, because he didn't want to do that. So we're going to look at this. What is the fear of man? Why is it a problem? And what do we do about it? So let's jump into the passage. So this is Galatians chapter 2, verse 11. When Peter came to Antioch, I opposed him to his face because he was clearly in the wrong. Before certain men came from James, he used to eat with the Gentiles. But when they arrived, he began to draw back and separate himself from the Gentiles because he was afraid of those who belonged to the circumcision group. The other Jews joined him in his hypocrisy, so that by their hypocrisy, even Barnabas was led astray. When I saw that they were not acting in line with the truth of the gospel, I said to Peter in front of them all, you are a Jew, yet you live like a Gentile and not like a Jew. How is it then that you force Gentiles to follow Jewish customs? We who are Jews by birth and not the Gentile sinners know that a man is not justified by observing the law, but by faith in Jesus Christ. So we too have put our faith in Christ Jesus so that we may be justified by faith in Christ and not by observing the law, because by observing the law, no one will be justified. If while we seek to be justified in Christ, it becomes evident that we ourselves are sinners, does that mean that Christ promotes sin? Absolutely not. If I rebuild what I destroyed, I prove that I am a lawbreaker. For through the law, I died to the law so that I might live for God. I've been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. I do not set aside the grace of God, for if righteousness could be gained through the law, then Christ died for nothing. Let's pray. Father, as we dive into this text this morning, I pray that you would be with me and all the study that I have done for this passage. I pray that I would submit all of that to you and that by your power you would speak through my mouth. I pray that you would help me to get out of the way so that we could all see the truth that must be brought to bear, the truth that you love us with an unending love and that we have nothing to fear, but that we should only trust in you. Please increase our faith that we might trust you more. Help us to throw off all that hinders and run the race marked out for us. Help us to remember that we can do nothing in and of ourselves. It is Christ in us. Help us to rely fully on you, and I do that right now with my words. Love you, God. Amen. So first off, what is the fear of man? What is the fear of man? The fear of man, quite simply, is the need to win the approval of people for right standing in a community. There's another word for this. Can you think of what it is? That's right. People pleasing. People pleasing. I think this is a huge issue for Christians. People pleasing. In order to really understand the fear of man, I think it actually helps us to understand what it means to fear God. So we're going to juxtapose those two. The fear of man will prove to be a snare, but whoever trusts in the Lord is kept safe. In other words, trusting God is the opposite of the fear of man. The fear of the Lord means that you trust God for all things. You trust him in his ways to provide for your needs. You trust him with your health. And you trust him to guide you in wisdom. Proverbs 9:10 says it this way, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. To fear the Lord means that you trust him in all areas of your life, and to fear man means that you trust man-made systems and worldly thinking instead of God. And what did the Proverbs say? The fear of man will prove to be a snare. A snare. And I think there's no better way to explain this than Admiral Akbar. It's a trap. Admiral Akbar knows it's a trap because it had been revealed to him that it is a trap. But if you aren't aware, the fear of man is a trap, and it's a hidden trap. Why? Because the whole world, who does not know God, trusts in man-made systems and their own heart to guide them. You might remember that analogy, like a light on the bow of a ship, they follow only themselves. We want to be led not by our fear of man and people-pleasing, but our trust in God, knowing who he is, knowing his character, knowing his attributes, and loving him first and foremost. So to explain this, I want to go to this passage. So Paul has been explaining to the Galatian churches why it's so incredibly foolish to go back to works of the law and to the sign of circumcision for salvation. And he's trying to tell the churches, that's not the way of the cross. That's not the gospel. And if you are hearing that that's the gospel, it is no gospel at all. It is not the truth. Because the gospel is simply faith in Christ alone. Nothing else. You can only be justified by trusting in Christ. His work, his perfection, his life, his death, his resurrection. That's the gospel. And so when Paul hears that the Galatian churches are hearing a different gospel, and in fact, Peter himself is starting to believe this because some important people from Jerusalem came, those who believed this, the Judaizers, the ones who believed you had to be circumcised and follow the law. When he saw them, they were so important in his eyes that he said, I don't want to disappoint those guys. And they see that I'm eating with these Gentiles. Maybe I should not do that. Now, keep in mind, this is after Peter had received a vision from the Lord. You might remember this from Acts chapter 10. Peter had a dream. And in his vision from the Lord, a sheet from heaven, very strange dream, comes down and opens up in front of him, and in the sheet are all kinds of animals that were previously to all Jewish people considered unclean. And God tells Peter in this dream, rise, kill, and eat. Which I think is an amazing thing because God made cows and pigs out of meat. So we should eat them, right? Especially pigs. They make bacon, and Peter had never enjoyed the beauty of bacon before. But this was not, for him, this was a little scary because he had never eaten anything unclean before. In fact, he tells God that. He says, I can't eat these things because I've never eaten anything unclean. You know how unlawful it is for a Jew to eat these things. And do you remember how God responds to him? He says, do not call unclean what I have made clean. God had made these animals clean. And this whole dream was symbolic because the Jews, and Paul says it when he says in verse 15, the Gentile sinners, the Jews always considered those who were not Jewish unclean. But God was going to make them clean, not by works of the law, not by circumcision, but by faith in Christ alone. And Peter knew this. He remembered the dream, and he knew this. But when the Judaizers came in, and he held them in high esteem, and he knew that this is what they were teaching, he didn't want to upset them, and he wanted to have a high standing too. It's called the fear of man. Now, in Acts chapter 10, it says, you yourselves know how unlawful it is for a Jew to associate with or to visit anyone from another nation, so Gentiles. But God, Peter says, has shown me that I should not call any person common or unclean. The implication of the gospel is that everybody's in the same boat. It doesn't matter, Jew or Gentile. In fact, we're going to read this later in Galatians. Galatians chapter 3, verse 28 through 29. There is neither Jew nor Greek or slave or free or male or female. You are all one in Christ. We all start on the same plane, in the same boat, sinners in need of a Savior. And we are all only ever justified by faith in Christ alone. Doesn't matter who you are, what your past is like, what your pedigree is, how you grew up. It is only by the person and work of Christ. And Peter knew this, yet he wasn't acting like he knew this. And this is what the fear of man does to us. Now, the fear of man can also be described in a couple different ways. So I just want to, real quick, this is kind of a side note. All of the disciples knew after Jesus left that they were going to have to face intense persecution because Jesus told them so. He told them in Luke 12, he says, I tell you, my friends, don't be afraid of those who can kill the body and then after that can do no more, but I will show you who you should fear. Fear him who, after your body has been killed, has authority to throw you in hell. Yes, fear him. Now, were the disciples afraid? Yes, they were. But they feared God more. They trusted God more. And so all of the disciples died a martyr's death, except for Judas, who hanged himself, and John, who was exiled on the island of Patmos and died of old age. We, human beings, do fear things that can happen to the body, don't we? Just see COVID 2020. We fear things that can happen to the body. But I think more than fearing things that can happen to our bodies and our physical health, I really think that we fear more what other people think about us. And I think that we often live our lives in such a way that proves that. I remember in high school, I grew up in Iowa, rural Iowa, and we would have drag races on the quarter mile between the turnout of Messina, where I grew up, and the bridge. It was almost exactly a quarter mile. So my first car was a 1990 Ford Probe. I don't think they make those anymore, but it was a 5-speed and a manual transmission. In fact, everybody had a manual transmission because if you didn't have a manual when you were in high school, you were kind of a nerd. And so I remember racing that car and, really kind of making a name for myself because I beat McCade Morrison in his short box Chevy 350 in my Ford Probe. Double clutching, that really works. So when I got my second car, because the Probe died, had 400 and some thousand miles on it, third engine, when the Probe died, I got a Dodge Stratus. And it was an automatic. And so when I would go into town, into Atlantic, where there were hills, and I'd be at a stoplight, I would put my automatic in neutral and roll back a little, so that people thought I had a manual. Because I cared about what other people thought about me. People that didn't even know me at all. Ooh, that guy has a manual Dodge Stratus. Why do we do this to ourselves? Why do we fear what other people think of us and orient our lives around that instead of just trusting God and not being afraid of anything? Well, as the Proverbs tells us, it's a trap. Beep. I think it might be dead, Robino. It's a trap. No, it's working. It's a trap. We have put ourselves in these situations all the time. The trap of needing to be viewed as progressive and relevant and politically correct by the important people or the people in the workplace around us, people of influence, so as not to be rejected by them. So you act a certain way around these people, and you act a certain way around those people. You swear and enjoy filthy jokes around these people, but definitely not around these people. I could always tell the kids in high school who didn't give a rip, didn't struggle with the fear of man at all, because when I was a youth pastor, I would come on campus, and the kids who didn't struggle with the fear of man would be like, Casey, what's up? How's it going? And they would talk. But the kids who, and maybe it was just a fear of bald man, I'm not sure, but the kids would, if they saw me, they would look the other way really quick and walk away. Oh no. I don't want them to know what I'm like at school. Now, when you're in high school, it is an enormous struggle, the fear of man. But as you get older, I feel like it gets worse. It doesn't go away. It actually seems like it gets worse. The stakes are higher. You know, when you're in high school, it's like really, like you're caring about what you wear, what you drive, you know, and sometimes important things, like if I don't get these grades, I won't look like, you know. But when you're an adult, you feel like maybe your career is on the line. Maybe your reputation is on the line. And so you orient yourself in such a way that you are actually driven not by the fear of God, not by trusting God, but by the fear of man. And it's a trap. The trap of needing to be seen as intellectual and informed on every topic. The trap of needing to be successful the way that the world defines success. Financial affluence, upward mobility, how many experiences you've had, how many places you've traveled. I have a good friend who has literally done everything you could think of in the whole world. And he'll tell you, that ain't it. That's not it. It's a trap. The trap of self-deprecation and self-hatred because of deep shame and trauma, mistakes you've made, addiction, not quite meeting up to the beauty standards of the day, and deciding just not to be around people in order to appear that you have your life together. So why is this a problem? Why is the fear of man a problem? Well, it's a problem because it does a couple of things. Let's look back to the scriptures. Verse 12, but before certain men came from James, he used to eat with the Gentiles, but when they arrived, he began to draw back and separate himself from the Gentiles because he was afraid. He was driven by the fear of man, of those who belonged to the circumcision group. The other Jews joined him in his hypocrisy, so that by their hypocrisy, even Barnabas was led astray. Listen to this verse. When I saw that they were not acting in line with the truth of the gospel, I said to Peter in front of them all, you are a Jew, and yet you live like a Gentile and not like a Jew. So how is it then that you force Gentiles to follow Jewish customs? When you are driven by the fear of man, you do two things. You will live to win the approval of people. And if you live to win the approval of people, you will not live according to the truth of the gospel. You will walk in a manner that is not in line with the gospel. You could say, I believe that the gospel is true, but you're not living out the gospel implications. We have a word for this. It makes you, as he says to Peter, a hypocrite. A hypocrite. It makes you a hypocrite. And here we see Peter acting this way. And the others, so he looked up to the Judaizers. He had a fear of them, so he was driven by his fear of man. Well, Barnabas looked up to Peter. And so he also is then driven by the fear of man because of Peter's influence. When you are driven by the fear of man and not trusting God, it makes you a hypocrite, but it also influences others around you who are looking up to you. Oh, this is how Christians talk? Oh, okay, well, I guess that's all right then. Oh, this is how Christians behave? Well, I guess it's okay for me then. And you compromise and you compromise and you compromise. Why? Because everybody else is doing it. Like a bunch of lemmings. He's jumping off a cliff. Why not me? It makes you a hypocrite. What does this word even mean? Do you know what the word hypocrite means? Anybody know? What, say it loud? To act. An actor. We live in a culture that celebrates to the highest degree hypocrites. Oh my gosh, look, it's the person who pretends to be someone they're not. We call them actors, and we give them shiny awards because they're so good at it. Actors are some of the most esteemed people in our entire culture. Now, yes, it is because they entertain us, and they can tell great stories, and trust me, if anybody loves a good film, it's me. I love film. But who are also the most influential people who maybe shouldn't be? Actors. Are you pretending in your walk with Christ? If you're pretending, it's probably because you're driven not by trusting in God, but by the fear of man. You're afraid of what others will think, of what others will say if you allow your light to shine. And if this is the case, you're not acting in line with the gospel. Paul says in Romans 1:16, I'm not ashamed of the gospel. Why? Because in the gospel is power unto salvation. People who are dead in their trespasses and sins, when they hear the gospel, can come to resurrected life. This is an unbelievable miracle and a power that God has given to his people. And he says, go out. You have nothing to fear. You have nothing to hide. No fear, no doubt, no shame, no sorrow. There is nothing that can separate you from the love of God. And if God is for us, who can be against us? When we're a hypocrite, we may say that we believe that Jesus provides for our needs, but if I don't cut some corners on my taxes this year, I'm going to lose money. And for what? To give to the government? What are they going to do with it? Not build roads. You say that you trust Jesus with your future, but you spend endless nights lying awake and drowning in anxiety over the things that you said, over the things that you did, over the things you probably will say and do. You say that you've trusted Christ to rescue you from the slavery of sin, but you continue to offer yourself as a slave to that exact same sin. You say that you want to follow Jesus with your whole heart, but you've relegated him and the implications of the gospel to the margins of your life for the centrality of comfort. I love Jesus so much, so long as he doesn't take up too much of my time. I mean, I can give an hour on Sunday. That's fine. Music's really good, so. Join a home group? Oh, no. With people? No. What are you, nuts? I'm not going to join a home group. They might make me eat with them. I might be healed of spiritual depravity and depression. They might make me study the scriptures and I might be enlightened to know new things about God and grow in my knowledge and love for him. I might have to confess my sins so that I'm finally set free from this addiction and slavery. I'm not joining a home group. They might care for me mentally and physically and spiritually and make me food when I'm sick and love me unconditionally, as only a brother and sister in Christ can do. Why would you be driven by the fear of man when what's offered you is God? God offers you life and life abundantly, in and through the person and work of Christ and through his people, the church. Peter was being a hypocrite, and Paul told him that. He said, you know the gospel, Peter? Why are you living like you don't? Why are you separating yourself from the Gentile sinners and joining these Judaizers who are the real sinners? Because they're thinking they can be justified by their works of the law and by circumcision. And he says in verse 15, we who are Jews by birth and not Gentile sinners know that a man is not justified by observing the law, but by faith in Christ. So we too have put our faith in Christ Jesus so that we may be justified by faith in Christ and not by observing the law. Because by observing the law, no one will be justified. He literally says the same thing three times, three different ways. I remember when I was a director at camp, the kids would come up to me and they'd be like, can I have another brownie? And I'm like, no, you've already had one and we all can only have one brownie. The next kid, literally right next to him. But can I have a brownie? No, you cannot have a brownie. So what I started doing is I was saying, there are brownies. You cannot have them. Have them not the brownies you can. These brownies here are not for you. For you, these brownies are not. And I would say it so many different ways that there was no possibility that any child in the room could possibly ask for a brownie, and yet they still did. Paul is saying, look, you are not justified by works of the law. By works of the law, you are not justified. You are not justified by works of the law, but only by faith in Christ. So we've been building up to this point. He's been building his argument, and here he overtly says it. He says, if you are driven by the fear of man, what you're trying to do is you're trying to gain for yourself a right relationship, not with God, but with other people through your own works. That's dangerous. And it's a trap, and you'll be stuck, and you won't be able to grow. He says, what you need to do instead is remember something different. You need to die to self. What is the truth of the gospel, the simple truth of the gospel? And what do we do about it? We live out this truth by embracing the truth of the gospel and its implications. So not just say, I believe that Jesus Christ is my Savior and my Lord, and he's transformed my life. We have to live in such a way that people can look into our life and know that that's true. We live out the implications of the gospel. We have to die to self and live for Christ, because it's Christ that lives in us. Paul says it like this in verse 17. If while we seek to be justified in Christ, it becomes evident that we ourselves are sinners, does that mean that Christ promotes sin? No. No. If I rebuild what I destroyed, I prove that I'm a lawbreaker. For through the law, I died to the law so that I might live for God. Paul's basically reiterating what he has said, and of course what he unpacks in the entire book of Romans. He says, the law revealed to me that I need Jesus. The law said, do not covet, and I coveted. The law said, do not murder, and I hated my brother in my heart. The law said, do not commit adultery, and I lusted after a woman in my heart. It revealed to me that I'm a sinner. And so if I try to build my righteousness on the law, what I'm saying is that Christ died for nothing. I can do it on my own. I'm just going to try harder. I'm going to try really, really hard to gain righteousness with God. And at the same time, because I don't want to disappoint other people, I'm going to try to live in such a way that people approve of me too. Paul says, that's like putting your foot in a bear trap. It's you're not going to move, and it really hurts. It's a horrible way to live. And he says, the way that you ought to live then is to die. To die to self. At the center of the gospel is a man crucified for the sake of sinners being set free. Freedom in Christ to live without the fear of man. In order to live without the fear of man, something must die, and that thing is you and your old self. Death to self-reliance, death to self-righteousness, death to the fear of man by way of total trust in Christ. When a person accepts Christ as their Savior, they're believing by faith that their old self was crucified with Christ. Look at verse 19. For through the law I died to the law so that I might live for God. I have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I now live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. I do not set aside the grace of God, for if righteousness could be gained by the law, then Christ died for nothing. You get a new reality when you accept Jesus Christ as your Savior. You are given the ability to live out the implications of the gospel by accepting these truths. The truth that Jesus loves you. That Jesus loves you unconditionally. That while you were still a sinner, Christ died for you. That's how much he loves you. And so the implications are, we get to love him back. And we get to love others. The truth that Jesus rescued us, not because we were worthy, but because he is filled with grace and mercy. The truth that the gospel makes us free to enjoy true fellowship with other believers without the fear of judgment. We don't need to fear man and what man thinks of us. We can trust God that he will establish us. That when we sin, he is there to advocate for us. When we confess our sins, he is just and will forgive our sins. The truth that we don't need to win the approval of others if we've already won the approval of God. Now, we didn't win it, did we? Jesus won it for us, and he gives it to us. We can only do this, however, if we remember that this is not... Oh, sorry, Aaron. This is a good time to announce Fireside. We can only do this if we remember that it is not in and of ourselves. We don't have the power to pick ourselves up by our bootstraps and try harder. No. Verse 20, I've been crucified with Christ. I wrote down this verse in 1 Peter 3, because I thought of it this morning. For Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, to bring you to God. He was put to death in the body, but made alive in the spirit. That's what's happened to you. When you came to spiritual life, you were crucified with Christ. Your old self was nailed to the cross. And you get a new resurrected life in Christ. So that the good deeds that you do and the life that you live is not your own life. It's Christ's life in you. So that by that life, you bear good fruit. We're going to talk about that at the end of Galatians. Are you crippled by your need to please other people? Are you afraid of what other people will think of you? I want to give you a challenge. Throw caution to the wind. Be crucified with Christ and let him live in you. Let's pray. Father, as we consider this truth that we are often driven by the fear of man, I know it's certainly true of me. I think of days when I feel that I've preached a doozy of a sermon and I head straight to my car to go home. And Lord, I ask that you would forgive me for my fear of man. Thank you for the power of your word to transform us. Lord, there isn't a time that I spend in your word that doesn't end in some sort of transformation, be it ever so small. And God, we desperately need that. We need your transforming power in us so that we will not be driven by the fear of man, but that we will live as one who has Christ in us. I pray that we would reject the way of the world and embrace the truth of the gospel and its implications. The beauty of the gospel that we have been reconciled to a holy God, and if he is for us, who can be against us? And that we have nothing to fear. Father, I pray for this body. I pray that we would be lights shining on a hill, salt in a flavorless world. That you would use VCF to bring the gospel to bear in the valley. And that we would not be ashamed of the gospel, for it's the power of God unto salvation. And there are people, God, who need rescued. Father, we desperately need you. We need your power. We need your might. We need you to move in us, to transform us and make us like you. We love you, God. We lift these things to you in faith.